just alone. I place my trust and find my glory in the power of the cross. In every victory, let it be said of me, my source of strength. Welcome to our Hope in Christ program. In today's episode, we will talk about helping the poor together. This is a noble call for us to respond to, helping the poor together. So before we continue, let's come to the Lord in a word of prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that today you will speak to not only to us, but to our audience, to the listeners. We pray that as we talk about partnership in helping the poor, that this will be an inspiring and encouraging talk we will be able to share with the audience. Help both Father Paul and me as we try to relate to this important call. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. Well, today we have a very special guest all the way from Manila. We have a resource person to help us in this talk about helping the poor together. So I'd like to welcome Father Paul from Quezon City. Welcome, Father Paul.
Thank you very much indeed.
I'm very happy to have you here in this program. And can you tell us a little bit about what kind of ministry involvement you are doing there in Quezon City?
Okay, yes. Really, there's two main aspects to my work. I'm part of, my work with the poor, that is. Mm. I'm part of a Catholic religious order called Missionaries of God's Love, mm-hmm. and we run a parish called St. Benedict's Parish in Manila. Mm-hmm. So my work is the focusing on work with the poor, and there's two main aspects of that. Mm-hmm. One is within the parish, uh-huh. and the other, which at the moment really is taking up most of my energies, is in Piatus. Mm-hmm. There's a foundation that I started in Piatus called Puso ng Ama, Heart of the Father. Mm-hmm. And that the aim of that really is to help people experience God's love. Mm-hmm. Let's start before that.
Okay.
The vision that inspires us in Puso ng Ama is to see a world more like heaven.
Uh-huh.
To see a world more like heaven.
Mm, that's wonderful.
We do not believe that heaven will come until Jesus comes again. We don't believe in confusing heaven with earth. But Jesus said, pray every day. Mm. Well, he didn't say pray every day. He said, this is how you should pray.
Mm.
Your will be done on earth
as it is in heaven.
Mm. So we should be desiring to see this world becoming more like heaven. And in heaven, there's no poverty.
Mm-hmm.
In heaven, there's no hunger. In heaven, there's no thirst. Mm-hmm. In heaven, there's no homelessness. There's no nakedness.
Mm-hmm.
In heaven, everyone knows the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
In heaven, there's pure ligaya, joy, mm-hmm. peace.
Mm-hmm.
So the vision that inspires us is, even if in a little way, to make this world, especially the poor areas,
mm-hmm.
to make poor areas more like heaven. And in order, that's the vision that inspires us,
mm-hmm.
and how we want to do it is to help people experience
mm-hmm.
God's love, to accept God's love, to then be transformed by God's love through Jesus,
mm-hmm.
and then because of that transformation, to be moved, to be impelled, to be moved to action,
mm-hmm.
to help change this world and make this world more like heaven.
Mm, that's wonderful, no? It's wonderful to see you initiating actions like that. And so what are the practical efforts that you do to help the poor?
Okay, practically, I guess you'd say there's different areas. First of all, I'd say we see things holistically.
Okay.
So we separate this aspect from this aspect from this aspect. But of course, we do need to distinguish
mm-hmm.
different aspects.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, there's a spiritual aspect.
Mm-hmm.
At the heart of things, We do want people to know Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
We do want people to experience the love of God the Father through Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
We do want to see people become disciples, missionary disciples.
Mm-hmm.
We also want to see people become what we call missionary servants.
Mm-hmm.
By that we mean people who have experienced God's love.
Mm-hmm.
And because they've experienced it through Jesus, they want to share that love with others, especially the poor.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they are poor themselves,
mm-hmm.
to go out and share God's love with others as servants.
Mm-hmm.
And that means not just through words,
mm-hmm.
but practically in their actions. So the spiritual side of things is the overarching thing.
Mm-hmm.
But then we are concerned with education.
Mm-hmm.
We're concerned with livelihood. We're concerned with health,
mm-hmm.
and we'd like to be concerned with all sorts of other areas.
Mm-hmm.
So in the area of education, for example, maybe I could say a bit more about that.
Mm-hmm, sure.
Because poverty, because we're concerned to get people out of poverty.
Mm.
And to get out of poverty, you really need education.
Yeah, that's
right.
It's
almost impossible to exit poverty if you don't have a good or adequate education.
Mm. Mm.
It doesn't automatically mean you'll get out of poverty if you have a good education, but if you don't, there's almost no chance.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to see the poor have a good education.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the first barriers to that is that many of the poor, let's say in Piatas where we are, many of the poor are not even in the school system.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them dropped out after elementary school,
mm-hmm.
While they're in high school. Some of them dropped out in elementary school, and some didn't even start.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the first category of people that we want to try to help get a good education. So some of those we might see if we can get them back into public schools or whatever.
So you provide scholarship, something like that?
Yes, but for that group who are out of school, we have a alternative learning system.
Mm-hmm.
So at the moment we just got a very small program,
mm-hmm.
but we're about to start a larger program in partnership with a group called Geekonomics,
mm-hmm.
and which is linked with Goward Kalinga,
mm-hmm.
and it's called ClickMe, Click Mobile Education,
mm-hmm.
and there's three aspects to that. There's the alternative learning system for those who are out of school. There's skills and vocational life training, and then there's also job placement.
Mm-hmm.
So the out of schools people is one segment.
Mm-hmm.
Then those in school, we want to try to help some to get scholarships,
mm-hmm.
to get sponsorships. That's a big important aspect.
Mm-hmm.
Then another aspect is trying to help people study, because the conditions that many of the poor live in
are not conducive for studying.
So we're in the process of setting up a study club,
uh-huh.
which is a room dedicated to study.
Uh-huh.
So people who come there, they come there only to read, to do their assignments, to research, or to study. And then we'll have some people around who can also help with them.
Uh-huh.
Then we also hope, in the next few months, we're hoping to set up a tutorial and review center.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about the rich who go to good schools,
mm-hmm.
many of them, even though they go to a much better school than the poor go to, mm-hmm. on top of that, they pay for reviews and tutorials.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd like to provide that as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's education, one area. Mm-hmm. Health is another area. Last Sunday, we had a medical mission.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure we had around 200 and approximately 250 people came for eye tests.
Uh-huh.
We had 150 came for dental treatment. I'm not sure how many came for children, but I think it's 200, 300,
uh-huh.
And about 100 or something came for adult services. So the medical side is another aspect.
Uh-huh.
There's a lot more we'd like to do on the medical side and also on the health education and preventative side. Livelihood, vital, because rangatao kailang nila ng hanap buhay. People need livelihood.
Piatas is a former dump site, no?
Okay, it's a present.
Present. No,
it's not. There is a large dump site there.
Mm.
You know, most people in the Philippines, they think Piatas, dump site. New Smoky Mountain. But actually, the dump site is only one part of Paiatas.
Mm-hmm.
It's big, it's huge, but it's only one part. But yes, it's a very prominent part. You see it there, and garbage is all around. Mm. That provides a livelihood for tens of thousands of people.
Many of them. So you're involved in many areas with the livelihood, the health, the education, and of course, even in the issues of helping rehabilitate the drug dependent people, perhaps. You might be involved in something like that to help those who are involved in drugs.
Okay, that's an area where I think it's vital that we move into. Because it's such a prevalent problem. Take car life now. This is another area within our parish. I was asking the young people there how many young people they think are on drugs. And most of them said probably at least 50%.
It's a big number.
It's a big number. And the other day I had some people from England, just 2 days ago, to Paiatas. And as we were walking along, out of a window, we saw some people selling drugs. And it's a big problem, and it's vital. And it also affects with what's happening at the moment about killings. Just this last Sunday, I had to go and pray with the family of someone who'd been shot dead. They live in a tiny house. When I say house, just one room, very small. The wife, only about 24 now, left behind. And two small children. A few weeks before that, I was praying with the family of someone else shot dead, leaving behind a 20-year-old sister who hasn't finished high school, who has a one-year-old baby. We hope to help her have alternative learning system. And then just a few weeks again, someone else, it goes on. So it's a vital area. We were seeking to look how we can move forward in that area. At the moment, we're not really, but the barangay wants us to move in that area. The barangay captain said, can we help in that? And we'd like to. But as yet, although I know one or two people, I have helped one person go to a rehab, but we're not really yet, but it's very much an area we want to.
Thus far, we have heard many good things that Father Paul is involved in. Now, when you mentioned a while ago about the Puso ng Ama Foundation, how did this thing begin? How did this start?
Oh, that's an interesting story. Okay, if you really want me to go back, it started when I was in England. The idea behind it started when I was in England. I was a seminarian, not yet a Catholic priest, studying to be a priest. And I was working in a parish in England which would be considered a poor parish. Not like some of the poverty you get here, but a poor parish. And for most people, young people in England, and including in our parish, they think church, dull, boring, irrelevant. And there are, within the Catholic Church now I'm talking about, within the Catholic Church in England, there's a few very vibrant communities or events and conferences, and I was thinking, I would love to be able to bring these young people along to them, to help them to see that following Jesus is not dull, boring, and irrelevant. So I was thinking about starting some sort of foundation, charity, to enable me to do that. But almost immediately, I felt the Lord say to me, it can't be just that. Yes, do that. But this foundation, this charity, has to be concerned as well about the poor around the world, especially poor children and young people about the world. And so I ended up starting a charity, a foundation, or in England we call it a charity, in England called Heart of the Father.
So it's the English version first.
And then I ended up coming to the Philippines. And so basically we set up a foundation here called Puso ng Ama, Heart of the Father, to try to help people here experience God's love, which isn't just spiritual. God's love doesn't just come to us in invisible ways. It comes to us as well through the material, through the tangible, through education, through housing, through clothing, through health stuff, social things.
So, Heart of the Father, is there a governing group of the Heart of the Father in England, and there's another different one for the Puso ng Ama?
Yes, they're completely separate now, actually. Initially, when we were thinking about it, we were thinking of Puso ng Ama as like a daughter or even just a channel. But even before we started, we realized, no, it has to be its own independent thing. So after a while, I actually stopped being a trustee of the foundation in England, although it still supports Puso ng Ama as it can. And I focused on Heart of the Puso ng Ama.
In the Philippines.
But we're linked still, but completely separate.
Okay. So, what is Puso ng Ama doing here in the Philippines now? What kind of things do you do as a foundation?
Okay. As a foundation, first of all, let me say this, is what we're concerned about is that people experience God's love and that we see communities, poor communities, transformed to become more like heaven. And it doesn't matter whether we're the ones doing it or whether other people do it. But we want to help it happen. But some of it we do ourselves. So as I've said, really we try to do it ourselves through providing some alternative learning for those who are out of school, providing scholarships, providing education, providing a study hub, providing medical services, we're partnering with a group again, Geconomics, to provide livelihood.
Okay, so have you been in partnership while you're doing this? Were there some evangelical church working with you along this line?
At the moment, not much, but a little. So, for example, our alternative learning system, we've partnered with a group called Simple Church. They're an evangelical church. And they're the ones who come and run our alternative learning system. Then there's another group called Lilok, who are, again, evangelical group, who are also, actually, alternative learning system again, very keen to partner with us. So we're looking at how we might do that. One of our youth workers is being trained by Lilok, an evangelical group. And then Corey and Stuart De Boer, who are well-known evangelicals, are very keen to see how we can partner together and work together. So we're really at the very initial stages of that. But my big dream and vision is to see Catholics and evangelicals
working together
against poverty.
Yeah, that's great. Is Lilok an acronym or what kind? Is that a name?
I'm actually not sure. It was started by Servants, a group called Servants to Asia's Poor. But it's now a separate ministry. But they have a farm in, and they have a retreat center in Tanai. But I'm not sure.
Yeah. Well, we know that just like what Jesus said, the poor you will always have with you. No, there will be lots of poor people all over the world. That's why we have lots of opportunities to help those who are less fortunate. In our part here in Bacolod, we are involved in helping street kids, street families. So we meet them every week. We feed the children. We also teach them the Word of God, the Bible. And eventually, for us to see transformation in the lives of the children, we need to partner with their parents. That's why we encourage the parents to be with us, so that what they learn with us through the Word of God will also be learned by the parents themselves, and together we help form or shape the future of these little ones. And I understand it takes a lot of love and sacrifice to work among the poor. No, you will have to sacrifice a lot of your comfort, your conveniences, the things that should have been easy for you. You'll have to maximize the resources you have to share with them, so somehow they can be helped as well. I understand that in Payatas, many people might be working in the garbage area.
Tens of thousands, yes.
Yeah, and these are people very susceptible to illness, to sicknesses, and it's not a very healthy environment in there. And yet, for them, that's their livelihood, no? That's where they earn the living. What do you do to at least help educate these poor families to get out from being garbage or doing their thing in the garbage? Do you also hold seminars with these people, trying to encourage them to explore other works?
I mean, to tell the truth, again, that's something very much at the infancy.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of scavengers, mm-hmm. as they're called, and I'm starting to explore with some of them, one in particular, about how we can do exactly what you're saying,
mm-hmm.
to help people get out from that poverty. But at the moment, that's in infancy stage. Mm-hmm. But again, alternative learning system is one aspect of that, uh-huh. that we're trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other aspect of that is scholarships. But it's difficult because it's not just giving someone a scholarship.
Uh-huh.
There's the whole environment and the whole pressure. And sometimes even if they have the money, there's pressure on the family because Walang hanap buhay, they need to go to the rubbish dump and earn.
Yeah, that's right.
It's a very difficult, uh-huh. difficult one, but it's an important area.
Right. Have you met some of those people that you're trying to minister to that after several years were finally able to move out to somewhere and have their lives in a better situation by now?
Let me give you one example.
Okay.
Let me give you one example. Bea. Okay, uh-huh. yes. When I first met her, when uh-huh. I first met their family, they lived right next to the rubbish dump.
Uh-huh.
Very poor, very poor. And they used to go and sell to other people in the rubbish dump
uh-huh.
food, make uh-huh. food. And I have to be honest, when you first went there at that stage years ago, the whole where the house was, the whole place smelt like a rubbish dump, like uh-huh. a rubbish bin, rotten thick.
Uh-huh.
We gave Bea, I gave Bea a scholarship,
uh-huh.
and now she qualified as a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
She qualified as a SPED teacher.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what level. I think is it level 2 or level 3 SPED. And she's now doing her master's,
mm-hmm.
and she wants to give back and help. She wants to help the community.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an inspiration to me. As yeah. I see her, I say yes.
Your efforts paid off, no?
Yes.
At least you can cite the difference it made
yeah.
in this person and yeah. eventually in her family too. That's very encouraging. Of course, we have our own opportunities to help the poor in our areas, just like what Father Paul is doing in Payatas. Maybe we ourselves in our context, we can make a difference in the lives of some of these less fortunate kababayan natin. So it's a good thing that the Catholics and the Evangelicals are seeing this open door of working together, helping the poor, no? And I'm sure this is a welcome development, especially to our less privileged kababayan. So how are the poor people in Payatas receiving this when you extend the help like that? How welcome are you as far as this community of people are concerned?
Actually, very welcome. Very yeah. welcome. The people love, I guess
yeah.
actually. There's so much warmth, so much welcoming. There's so much need as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I've got to know so many people whom I love very much. They love me very much.
Mm.
It's full of both joys and sorrows.
Uh-huh.
It's full of a lot of extremes, to tell uh-huh. the truth. I have so much joy there,
uh-huh.
but also so much pain.
Yeah. Like, what are some of those things that causes you pain?
Okay, some of the things that cause me pain. Let me give two recent examples.
Uh-huh.
Oh, well, one recent example I already gave, so no need to repeat. But just praying over someone who's just shot dead,
yeah.
Praying over with their family. And that happens again and again. Another example, just very recently, there was a family whose father died
mm-hmm.
Right by the rubbish dump. Mm-hmm. I can't remember the exact dates, but died around 20th December, roughly. Mm-hmm. When I went there, it was 2 or 3 weeks later, they had no money to bury. Mm-hmm. And sometimes seeing the people in need, the great need, mm-hmm. and I can't always help.
Yeah.
You know, with the money or with this need. There's many times when I have helped, and so, but there's other times there's such a great need. Mm-hmm. And seeing that. Let me give you another example. One family. Mm-hmm. The father is dead. Mm-hmm. The only livelihood comes, the mother is sick. Mm-hmm. The mother has tuberculosis. Oh. Just a few weeks ago, has a relapse, mm-hmm. and was half a 500 milliliters of blood was coughing up. Mm-hmm. So the only income for the family is from the older sister who mm-hmm. scavenges on the rubbish dump. Mm-hmm. And she's part of our alternative learning system. Mm-hmm. But the two of the brothers are very involved with our work of evangelization. Mm-hmm. They're very faithful in following the Lord, actually. Mm-hmm. But one of them said to me, I don't want to have to leave education. I want to finish my studies. Mm-hmm. But because of his situation, he's scared about that because they don't have enough money. Mm-hmm. Or the younger sister said to me, you know what? I wish I could be sick rather than my mother.
Mm-hmm,
And there's so many. Let me give you one more. One mm-hmm, more. Mm-hmm. This one actually isn't Piatus. But when I first came to the Philippines, I used to live with some people whose livelihood was street vendors. Mm-hmm. I stayed a few months with them. And some years later, mm-hmm. I was back around the Ortigas area mm-hmm. where they sell sweets and cigarettes. Mm-hmm. And I saw, call him MJ, young boy, seemed very sick. Mm-hmm. And I asked, what's wrong? And they said that he was sick. They said that they'd gone to the doctor. They'd gone to the hospital, they'd gone to the doctor, and the doctor had prescribed something. Mm. They had a recibo per walang pera to buy
the medicine.
So I said to them, okay, where's the recibo? Maybe I can help. Sabahay daw. They said it was in the house. Mm. This was on a Wednesday. So I said, okay, I'll be back again on Friday. Bring the recibo and I'll see if I can help. Mm. I came back on Saturday. He was dead already. Then I asked them to give me the death certificate. Mm. And when they gave me the death certificate, it said dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. That is so preventable.
Yeah.
And they'd gone to see a doctor. Mm. That wouldn't happen to someone who's rich.
Yeah.
But because they were poor, they got some, I don't know what the placebo actually said, but and he died. I celebrated the funeral. I said the funeral for them and everything. Mm. But things like that are so sad.
Yeah.
And I could go on and on every day. Just a few weeks ago, taking people around, you know, there's a lady, her Hanat Buhay is peeling cassava. This is in Piatas. Mm. Peeling cassava. I think it's 12 sacks a whole day. 50 pesos a day for that. She has diabetes. She has to maintain stuff. I could go on and on and on.
How 12 sacks of?
I think it's 12. I think it's 12. I think it's 12.
And only 50
pesos a day. The whole day.
That was, hard work. Hard work with a very low.
Some people who say, oh, the poor, you know, I've seen the poor work so hard for so little.
That's right. Sometimes there's that generalization. They say, you are poor because you are lazy. If only you work, you will not be in that situation. But sometimes that will not always be the case for those who work so hard.
Not at all.
And just,
you have Masipag rich people, you have lazy rich people.
Yeah.
You have Masipag poor, industrious poor people, you have lazy poor people.
Right.
And I've seen so many clever, talented, intelligent, and hardworking poor people. Pero, they're still poor.
Yeah. Mm. Well, really, in life, no, there are many questions that are not always easy to answer, but we are confronted with realities that can really break our hearts. However, we have the choice. We have the opportunity to help. There could be many of us who are in a position to help the poor, I hope that we will not turn our back away from those who are in need. Father Paul, would you like to speak to our audience and encourage them to, in their own capacity, to help the poor whenever they are able?
Thank you. Yes, I would love to. I would love to. I would love, first of all, to ask each one of us that God might show us His heart of love for the poor. That's where it starts. For us to know and realize God's special love for the poor. Maybe that our hearts might be broken as God's heart is broken with love for the poor. And then also to realize what God says. So for example, you know, Jesus says, if you feed the hungry, you feed me. If you clothe the naked, you clothe me. If you visit those in prison, you visit me. If you shelter the homeless, you shelter me. But if you don't feed the homeless, you're not. If you don't feed the hungry, you're not feeding me. If you don't visit the homeless, you're not visiting me. If you don't visit prisoners or the sick, you're not visiting me. I'd really encourage us just to think about that. But then, okay, practically, practically, what can we do? I'd like to suggest three things. First of all, let's give our time. Okay, some of us may be called to work full time with the poor. Mm-hmm. Not the majority, but some of us. Let's be open to that. But for the rest of us, which is most of us, let's be prepared to give our time, voluntary. Find some organization, find some ministry, find some foundation, find some church, be part of something serving the poor. It might be on the ground, tutor, feed the hungry, do something. So give your time, or background support, administration, helping with the finances or something. But in some sort of way, you can give your time to help. Next, money. Work with the poor needs money. Give money. Some people think, oh, I can't give because I can't give a 10,000 a month, so I better not give at all. Okay, I talk for the Pusanangama Foundation. I'd like to say to people, but not just for us, but for other things as well, even if you can't give 5,000 a month or 1,000 a month, give 100 pesos a month, give 200 pesos a month. Ongoing, that will make a big difference if many people do that. So give your time, give your money, and thirdly, give your prayers. Find some group and pray for them specifically, pray for their ministry, pray for your church as it works with the poor. Time, money, and not just money, but donations of material resources and goods, and prayer.
Wow. Yeah, thank you so much, Father Paul. Really, just like what the Bible tells us, Jesus Christ said, whatsoever you do to the least of your brothers, you do it unto me. With that, we'd like to thank you for being with us in this episode. And I also would like to thank you, Father Paul. It's a blessing to meet you and to hear about what you're doing, you're passionately doing. Let's just have a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you that in this time we are able to speak to people we may not know, we may not have met yet, and yet we are able to communicate a message, an important message that you want all of us to participate in, helping the poor, encouraging the needy, and make a difference in the lives of some people. Thank you again for this privilege. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless us all.